Private Elliott, upon a point, sir. I'm picking up a large formation of planes at about 140 miles north, 3 degrees east, sir.
Yeah. We've got a flight of B-17s coming in from the mainland, Private. Don't worry about it.
December the 7th, 1941. An American radar officer warns of unidentified planes approaching Pearl Harbor. His warning is ignored. Over here. 30 minutes later, the Japanese in a surprise attack win the first round of the Pacific War. The Americans cannot afford, nor do they intend, to be caught out like this again. In a nuclear war, the maximum warning time of a missile attack would also be 30 minutes.
When action is required to preserve our national security, we will act. We will maintain sufficient strength to prevail if need be, knowing that if we do so, we have the best chance of never having to use that strength.
For 35 years, we've all been protected by a balance of terror. The strategists called it mutually assured destruction. What it meant was that neither side dared to strike first. That era is now over. Nuclear strategists on both sides now seek the ability to strike first, to totally destroy the opponent's nuclear arsenal before it can strike back. The Australian continent is the most important link in a global network designed by American defense strategists to win a nuclear war. Pine Gap, Narunga, Northwest Cape, Smithfield and Omega. Each of these bases serves a military function. Omega is the latest American installation to be built in Australia. Omega is a navigation aid for a wide range of American military vessels and aircraft, including submarines. The nuclear-armed submarine is the most invulnerable weapons system ever devised. Nearly three-quarters of America's long-range nuclear arsenal is carried aboard submarines. The threat of retaliation from Soviet submarines hangs over any attempt by the United States to win a nuclear war by striking first. Killer submarines are the answer to this threat. US killer submarines continually track and target the larger Soviet submarines that would have to be destroyed if the United States is to win a nuclear war. When completed, the Omega system will allow US killer submarines to navigate undetected throughout the oceans of the world. The Australian Omega station provides that final link in a global network of 8 stations. Since 1968, efforts to place this last Omega station somewhere in the South Pacific have been blocked by protesters' claims that Omega is a nuclear target. First rejected in New Zealand, then Tasmania, then New South Wales, Omega finally found a home in 1979 when the Australian Minister for Transport, Peter Nixon, offered to place the Omega station in his own electorate, Gippsland, Victoria.
The Foreign Affairs and Defence Committee of the Parliament made a study and reported to the Parliament on this and concluded that it had no defence significance at all, that there are other more sophisticated systems available for submarines and the like.
When Mr. Carter talked about the peace role that America wanted to play in the world, he said, just one of our relatively invulnerable Poseidon submarines carries enough warheads to destroy every large and medium-sized city in the Soviet Union. And that is what that base is all about.
Most landowners in the area would rather not see this thing here. The people that are loudest in its praise are the few individuals who can make some private gain.
We believe there was something in it for the locals, and that was one of the reasons why, of course, we were quite keen to see the facility built in this area. Paris has its Eiffel Tower, Sydney has its Harbour Bridge, and I think probably we in the Alberton Shire will be known by the Omega facility.
This is the first of the new generation of nuclear submarines called Trident. By 1981, two of these had been launched and another five were under construction. They will each carry up to 240 nuclear warheads. The extreme accuracy of each warhead means that Trident is now able to knock out Soviet missiles deep in underground silos. This accuracy is only possible using a new satellite navigation system called Navstar. By 1984, 24 Navstar satellites will circle the globe and will guarantee the accurate navigation of a nuclear missile to its target. The US base at Smithfield near Adelaide is a monitoring station for the Navstar satellite system. The possibility now emerging is that the United States, by combining its submarine and land-based missile forces, could theoretically destroy the entire Soviet nuclear arsenal by striking first. On the western coast of Australia is a top-secret communications base run by the US Navy. From Northwest Cape, a radio signal relays orders to submerged submarines, including the orders that could begin a nuclear war. In 1973, during the October War in the Middle East, the US Secretary of State, Henry Kissinger, placed America's nuclear arsenal on alert. The base at Northwest Cape relayed that order to submarines in the region and to the other US bases in Australia. When the crisis was over, the Australian government was told that the US bases had been on nuclear alert. The question of Australia sharing control of the US bases has been an issue since the United States established Northwest Cape in 1963. A conservative Australian government, headed by Sir Robert Menzies, then considered the idea of Australian control to be preposterous. The opposition Labor Party, headed by Arthur Calwell, was concerned over Australia's lack of control at the facility and opposed the terms of the agreement. During the election campaign in 1963, Labor was branded by Menzies as selling out on Australia's own defence. Labor lost the election. The defence alliance between Australia, New Zealand and the United States, known as the ANZUS Treaty, was central to Labor's dilemma. The Menzies government had signed the treaty in 1951. Labour supported it. And ever since, the question of Australia's defence has depended on ANZUS.
Bring their famous slouch hats, which are adapted from the bush hat worn by men of the Australian outback, diggers are named after the immigrants who dug for gold in the gold rush days of the 1850s. These soldiers are the third generation of Australians to leave for service overseas. But this is the first time they leave to support American, not British policy.
Australian troops have fought abroad in South Africa, Europe, Korea and Vietnam in support of Britain and the United States. None of these conflicts posed any threat to Australia's security.
New Zealand's efforts to promote a nuclear-free zone in the South Pacific are detrimental to Australia's security interests. The United States has recently made clear its objections to New Zealand's nuclear-free zone proposal and its dissatisfaction that an ANZUS ally should persist on a course which the US has declared harmful to its interests.
The US nuclear weapons system is greatly enhanced by its South Pacific allies. The declaration of a nuclear-free zone in the South Pacific is not possible under the ANZUS alliance, nor considered likely by US politicians. In 1974, US Defense Secretary James Schlesinger, in secret testimony, stated that bases such as Northwest Cape would be the most likely targets in a nuclear war. With the growing possibility of nuclear war, Australian conservative politicians have traded Australia's security for a front row seat in a clash between the superpowers.
Many of you might not know that the Australian government has insisted upon a certain rental which we Americans must pay for the use of this base. As a businessman, I must admit that the rent is very reasonable. It is, in fact, precisely one peppercorn per year to be paid upon demand. Here then, Mr. Prime Minister, I want to present you with one peppercorn payment in full for the first year's rent. I thank you very much. Thank you.
The Pine Gap base outside of Alice Springs, what's your understanding of its function?
I will not go into its function. All I can state, and it's my deep conviction, that it represents one of the greatest bonanzas to Australia.
James Jesus Angleton. Until 1974, he was head of counterintelligence at the CIA.
Unlike any other similar installation in the free world, it elevates Australia in terms of strategic matters.
Pine Gap is the most important base to the United States outside American territory. Both Pine Gap and Narunga, 500 miles to the south, will give early warning of a Soviet nuclear first strike. Or they will be essential in helping the United States to launch theirs.
There are many possible types of nuclear wars, ranging from nuclear wars which are fought by one side attacking the other cities, to attacks on military forces, limited nuclear wars, wholesale nuclear wars, controlled nuclear wars, uncontrolled nuclear wars. Now, if the United States is simply considering an attack on Soviet cities, then the loss of Pine Gap doesn't affect that. It can always attack Soviet cities. But it needs Pine Gap if it's going to fight limited wars and if it's going to fight controlled wars. Pine Gap is the only installation which can provide the sort of real-time intelligence on military targets in the Soviet Union, how those targets are changing, which ones need to be hit, and it's the only facility which can provide control in the undertaking of those attacks.
This satellite, monitored at both Pine Gap and Narunga, will detect the tail plume of a Soviet missile at liftoff. The warning is flashed instantly via a relay satellite to US command centers. If the Americans are to strike first, the same satellite will tell them whether their weapons are on target. If satellites play the key role in nuclear strategy, then killer satellites are the obvious countermove. The development of killer satellites adds a dangerous new dimension to the threat of nuclear war. The ability to knock out early warning and communications satellites, once achieved by either side, will represent a dramatic shift in the balance of power. Pine Gap, with its capabilities for satellite monitoring, could provide information that is vital to America in its race against the Soviet Union to develop killer satellites. The Australian government is asking no questions. The bombing of Cambodia, July 1973. Reconnaissance photographs supplied by Pine Gap satellites provided accurate targeting for bombing raids by the B-52s. The Australian government was not informed. These same B-52s have now been allowed landing rights at Darwin in northern Australia. According to the United States Air Force, these planes will not carry nuclear weapons.
Well, we've got the best possible guarantee that there could be. We have the assurance of the Secretary of State of the United States that these aircraft are unarmed and will carry no bombs.
Alice Springs, population 15,000, lies 15 miles from Pine Gap and is home for 250 American families.
More than 15,000 people a year visit this place. These tourists with them, millions of them come here. From not only Australia, all over the world, they come and say, what a beautiful place. Are they going to do that when a bomb drops here? Nobody's going to come here for the next 250,000 odd years, I suppose.
US base is out!
There are a group of concerned citizens here who campaign against the base on very many occasions. The Alice Springs people don't really comply with that. In fact, you might say they become anti-concerned citizens.
We've always been stressing that the base is a nuclear target, and they've always denied it. They've either denied it by not answering, or they've just come straight out and denied it.
I personally would not have my wife or my family living in Alice Springs if I considered that the risk of Pine Gap being suddenly hit by a nuclear weapon was very great. So my view is, no, this talk about it being a prime nuclear target, I don't accept, and it just doesn't worry me.
I've got no idea of what would happen if we had a nuclear and an attack itself. Except that I know Pine Gap is 15 miles out of town, and unless they had a direct hit on the town instead of Pine Gap itself, we might be in trouble. But apart from atmospherics and wind direction, I think we could be fairly safe.
Depending on wind direction, fallout from a nuclear strike on Pine Gap could cause the immediate deaths of 2,000 people in Alice Springs. Similarly, the city of Adelaide could expect an immediate death toll of 2,000 from fallout from a nuclear strike on Narunga, the early warning station 400 miles north of Adelaide. The Australian government has consistently denied that Pine Gap and Narunga would be nuclear targets. Calls for civil defence by some Alice Springs residents have so far been ignored.
Do you think that there ought to be some sort of civil defence organised for Alice Springs?
It's a hard question. I guess I don't really have an opinion.
But you live here, you must.
I don't feel any concern, really.
You don't feel any concern? Mm. Even though your family is here, you're set up.
Just one of those things, I guess.
Come on, 14. Let us help you now. Go to strike zone. Come on, Dan. Fire him up there, man. Come on, Terry.
The few examples that we know about where base employees have violated this code, they've been pretty severely and quickly dealt with, and so it's not a wise thing to express any views on any topics like this. They're here for the job, they're here to make money, they're here presumably because they believe in the particular concept of the base.
I certainly feel the work's important. I guess that's about all I can say. I don't know if I answered your question or not.
Most of the American employees at Pine Gap work under contract for the Central Intelligence Agency, making Pine Gap the largest and most important CIA base outside the United States. The man responsible for setting up Pine Gap was Richard Stallings. According to the Foreign Affairs Department in Canberra, Stallings was working for the United States Department of Defence. As far as the Australian government was aware, Pine Gap was to be a joint facility run by the Defence Departments of Australia and the United States. Unknown to the Australian government, Richard Stallings was working for the CIA, and the CIA was to run Pine Gap. Stallings and another senior CIA man, Victor Marchetti, drafted the Pine Gap Treaty laying out the ground rules for cooperation between the two governments. Victor Marchetti explains further.
The treaty is the trade-off. In return for your real estate and your logistical support, etc., we will share all the information we acquire through this technical project with you.
Like Northwest Cape, Pine Gap would soon prove to be a dilemma for the Australian Labor Party.
The ABC's computer says that with two-thirds of the votes counted, the national swing to Labour has been 3.7%.
There won't be a press conference there.
1972. After 23 years of Conservative rule, Australians had elected as Prime Minister the Labour leader, Edward Gough Whitlam.
I don't want to repeat it, gentlemen.
Thank you, Mr. Whitlam. Mr. Whitlam is now going out into the garden to join the hundreds of supporters who are just clamouring to congratulate him. Women are now kissing him, men shaking his hand.
Well, how does it feel to be Prime Minister-elect?
I'm not used to it yet, I suppose. Mind you, I suppose I've had fewer hours sleep this last 12 hours than I have for some years past, so you can't expect me to be too scintillating, or have collected all my thoughts in this.
Does the job frighten you at all, sir?
Not in the least.
The CIA, as was shown by their reporting from Canberra before the election, they were even surprised that Whitlam won the 1972 election. The CIA didn't have very good knowledge of Australia, even though they have one of their most important facilities in this country, and that's Pine Gap. This led to their paranoia. It's a vital facility for them. Their misunderstanding of Whitlam led them to think that he would remove it from Australia, or that there was a danger the Labor government might remove it.
In opposition, you and Mr. Barnard both raised the question of the American military installations in Australia, with particular reference to the secrecy surrounding them. Could you at this time, sir, indicate the policy your government will take on these questions?
There now need be no secrecy, because Mr. Barnard and I can find out whatever we want to.
In 1972, the secret operations of Pine Gap were unknown to both Gough Whitlam and Soviet intelligence. The CIA hoped to keep it that way. The American spy, Christopher John Boyce. At the age of 24, he was sentenced to 40 years imprisonment for selling classified information on Pine Gap's operations to the Russians. According to Boyce, he was witness to interference by the CIA in the political events that toppled the Australian Labor Government on November the 11th, 1975. In the class of 69 at Palos Verdes High School, California, Chris Boyce and Dalton Lee were the best of friends. Dalton Lee was the local drug dealer. Chris Boyce, the eldest of nine children, lived nearby. Their father was an FBI agent. Their mother, a devout Catholic, wanted Chris to become a priest. But her eldest son had developed a passion for the ancient sport of falconry. After high school, he decided he would apply for a government grant to study the history of falconry. It was then that his father managed to find his son a job with a company called TRW Systems. TRW designs and builds satellites for the CIA. With his father's background, Christopher Boyce was soon cleared for top secret duties. "I'm working with birds," he told his old school friend Dalton Lee. To most of the workers at TRW, the room known as the Black Vault was strictly off limits. Here, as a code clerk, Boyce worked the cryptographic machines decoding CIA messages from around the world, including the two CIA stations in Australia, Pine Gap, and the American Embassy in Canberra. For more than two decades, the CIA had enjoyed a close working relationship with the Australian Security Intelligence Organisation, known as ASIO. Under the previous Conservative governments, ASIO had been a law unto itself. The new Labour government and ASIO regarded each other with mutual suspicion. After barely 3 months in office, the new Attorney General, Lionel Murphy, frustrated in his efforts to extract information from ASIO, paid them an extraordinary visit. He arrived before office hours one morning and seized ASIO documents. This action deeply disturbed both ASIO and the CIA.
It was a raid.
James Angleton.
Murphy barged in and tried to destroy the delicate mechanism of internal security. It's a tender plant that needs nourishment. Some of the major secrets that deal with the world I was once in were given to the Australian services. And when we saw this Whitlam government come into power and this Attorney General Murphy moving in, barging in, we were deeply concerned as to the sanctity of the information. You don't see the jewels of counterintelligence being placed in jeopardy by a party that had extensive historical contacts in Eastern Europe, that was seeking a new way for Australia, seeking roads to Peking.
Soon after gaining office, Gough Whitlam was briefed on the US bases by American officials, while the left wing of his own party demanded that Whitlam fulfill his election promise to inform the public on the role of the US bases.
I repeat, they are not parts of weapon systems. They cannot be used to make war on any country. We cannot disclose any more about their purposes because they're not our secrets. But ladies and gentlemen, what we've got to recognize is this, that if we seek to govern this country, the people are entitled to believe that we will do it responsibly. We never told the people at the election that we'd disclose other countries' secrets if we knew them.
Whitlam himself had not been told during his briefing that Pine Gap was run by the CIA. A prime objective of the Whitlam Labor Government was to regain control of Australia's mineral and energy wealth, which was largely in the hands of multinational companies, many of them American. This would require vast amounts of capital, which was not forthcoming from conventional international money sources. Whitlam left the business of loan raising to his treasurer, Dr. Jim Cairns, and his minerals and energy minister, Rex Connor. Together, they would try to raise loans of up to $4 billion from brokers in the Middle East. At the TRW plant in Los Angeles, Chris Boyce had been given a top secret briefing from the CIA. Of all the satellites monitored through Pine Gap, the one most cherished by the CIA was codenamed Rhyolite. Rhyolite is a volcanic rock composed of jumbled layers of quartz and feldspar. These patterns in the rock suggested to the satellite's designers the chaos of radio signals that the Rhyolite satellite could monitor from space. This smorgasbord of intelligence includes Soviet and Chinese missile tests, diplomatic telexes and military communications. Also snared in the Rhyolite net are Australia's diplomatic telexes, overseas and interstate telephone calls. The computers at Pine Gap are programmed to continuously search through this mass of information for key words or phrases that will trip the computer and record the message.
Information derived from the research programs conducted at the facility shall be shared by the two governments.
Under the sharing arrangements of the Pine Gap Treaty, anything of interest to Australian intelligence was to be passed straight to ASIO. By 1974, the CIA was having second thoughts about sharing intelligence with Australia.
Whitlam himself had gone so far in mid-1974 in Parliament as saying that there'd be no prolongation or extension of the leases on foreign bases in Australia. Soon after that, he told the American ambassador this did not apply to Pine Gap or Narunga, and he was had been answering a question about potential Russian bases in Australia. But the agency heard this kind of statement, read about it, and they had this idea, as Angleton has said, that the Whitlam government was some kind of mad socialist horde rampaging through the cupboard of secrets held by the Western Alliance.
Chris Boyce was now told of plans for a new spy satellite to be codenamed Argus. Boyce was ordered never to reveal the existence of Project Argus to the Australians. At his trial, Boyce claimed that Project Argus involved a daily deception of the Australians. He was deeply disturbed. Australia was one of America's closest allies. After Boyce was arrested, Victor Marchetti questioned him about Project Argus.
Project Argus is a project designed by the CIA to cut the Australians out of certain information being acquired through the Rhyolite project. They were either going to add channels to the Rhyolite system, and then the Australians would no longer be privy to, or they were going to cut the Australians out of the existing information that was coming down from Rhyolite. But in any case, it was a screw the Aussies type project.
By late 1974, the CIA's activities in Chile were made public in the United States. The year before, Chile's democratic socialist government had been overthrown and President Allende murdered. Brutal reprisals followed the takeover by Pinochet's military regime. Chris Boyce now suspected the covert activities of the CIA in Australia, and he made up his mind to strike back. He began to feed to Dalton Lee information on the CIA's Rhyolite satellites. Until now, the CIA had been secretly monitoring all Soviet missile tests through Project Rhyolite, giving the United States a distinct advantage in the arms race. When Dalton Lee offered the secrets of Rhyolite to the KGB in Mexico City, it was a revelation to the Soviets, and for Dalton Lee it became a lucrative sideline to his now flourishing drug business. In Australia, Minerals and Energy Minister Rex Connor had worked tirelessly in his efforts to raise loans in the Middle East, sending and receiving telexes and making many international phone calls.
There is a lot of Australian domestic, non-defence related communications being picked up. The Argus and Rhyolite satellites are capable of intercepting and recording telex communications, etc. A lot of Australia's internal telephone calls and a lot of Australia's overseas calls. The arrangement is that this material, when it goes back to the National Security Agency or the Central Intelligence Agency in the United States, is supposed to be filtered out and destroyed. There is no way of checking, though, whether in fact that is done.
I went along to see Dr. Ray Klein, who was formerly Deputy Director of the CIA, former head of the State Department's intelligence service. He made some quite astounding statements. He said that civil servants in Australia would have been made aware of information damaging to the Whitlam government by people in the CIA, that opposition politicians in Australia would have been made aware of any information damaging to the Whitlam government. He used this the conditional tense form, would have been, but he used it throughout the interview and he used it with such definiteness and repetition that he left a very clear impression that he was saying this is what happened.
By mid-1975, the loans affair, carefully orchestrated by the media, was taking its toll on the Whitlam government.
Including some of the extraordinary charges that have been made by these gutter snipe hirelings that some of your employers have engaged. They'll be able, for instance, to explain, if there is an explanation for this story in this morning's Age, that a London finance broker said that someone, in quotes, in Australia, had been prepared to pay up to $2 million to acquire certain vital documents relating to efforts by Australian ministers to raise multi-million US dollar loans.
It's clear, and I shouldn't think it would be necessary for you to proceed.
The former treasurer and now Deputy Prime Minister, Dr. Jim Cairns. In Parliament, Cairns denied signing a letter authorising loan raising on behalf of the government. When the opposition then produced a letter with Cairns' signature, the trap was sprung.
I have said that I'm making no comment on anything. It's substantially a matter to be discussed within the Labour Party, and that applies to all your questions. Is that clear?
Whitlam then sacked Cairns for misleading the Parliament, and the opposition leader, Malcolm Fraser, stepped up his campaign to bring down the Whitlam government.
This government has had more than a fair go. Yeah. This government has done harm to people who are old, who can't rebuild their lives. It's done harm to young people who can't afford to buy a home. It's done harm to the 500,000 that will be unemployed in February. And still he claims that he ought to be allowed to stay.
By November 1975, the opposition parties were able to gain control of the Australian Senate, the upper house. Whitlam still governed because of his popularly elected majority in the lower house.
We want justice! 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 We want justice!
We want justice! We want justice! Mr. Connor was back for line. Now, Dr. Ken. Now, Dr. Cairns says that Mr. Whitlam was lying.
In an unprecedented move, the opposition wielded its power in the Senate to block the money supply to the Whitlam government.
He is guilty. He is so guilty. The evidence is substantial.
In the gravest constitutional crisis in the history of Australia, the government was suddenly paralysed. It was then that an enterprising journalist discovered the connection between Pine Gap and the CIA by exposing Richard Stallings as a CIA agent. Gough Whitlam kept the issue alive by accusing the opposition country party leader, Doug Anthony, of receiving CIA money through his friend Richard Stallings. This publicity could not have come at a worse time for the Central Intelligence Agency.
After this agreement has been in force for a period of 9 years, either government may at any time notify the other government in writing that it desires to terminate the agreement.
In a month's time, the Pine Gap Treaty was due for renewal. The loss of such a vital strategic and intelligence facility could not be tolerated. The government of Gough Whitlam had become a national security risk to the United States. The Governor General, Sir John Kerr. Up until now, his role as the Queen's representative in Australia was considered largely ceremonial. But Sir John did not see it that way. He took his role as Commander-in-Chief of the Armed Forces very seriously. He had a background in wartime intelligence work and took a keen interest in security matters.
I saw Christopher Boyce in a jail in Southern California in 1979. He said that the CIA resident, the chief agency spook at the company at which he worked, TRW, had referred to our man Kerr, the CIA's man Kerr, and they'd called him an asset. In using the word asset, Boyce was using almost a CIA technical term. I'm not prepared to speculate about what he meant by our man Kerr, but asset is a term which CIA people use quite frequently and regularly, meaning someone usually in a highly placed position in a foreign government or foreign armed forces upon whom they can rely absolutely and implicitly, or whom they believe they can rely on, would be the safest way of putting it. And that was the word he used to describe the then Governor General.
On the 9th of November, Sir John Kerr was briefed by intelligence officials on the deepening security crisis between Australia and America. The next day, the ASIO liaison officer in Washington was instructed by the CIA to send the following cable to the Director General of ASIO.
On the 2nd of November, the Prime Minister of Australia made a statement at Alice Springs to the effect that the CIA had been funding Anthony's National Country Party in Australia. On the 4th of November, the US Embassy approached the Australian government and categorically denied that CIA had given money to the National Country Party or its leader. CIA cannot see how this continual reference to CIA can do other than blow the lid off those installations in Australia which are vital to both our services and countries, particularly the installation at Alice Springs. If this problem cannot be solved, they do not see how our mutually beneficial relationships are going to continue.
Strikes are spreading through Australia as workers protest the unprecedented dismissal of the Labor government of Gough Whitlam. Australia's Governor General John Kerr made the move, and his secretary made the announcement to a very hostile crowd.
The proclamation which you have just heard read by the Governor General's official secretary was countersigned Malcolm Fraser, who will undoubtedly go down in Australian history from Remembrance Day 1975 as Kerr's Kerr.
The CIA don't do these things for their health. They're just to play games. There's a goal there, and the goal is, I think, was to get rid of Whitlam. That was the whole purpose, I think, was to bring in somebody that they were much closer with and could feel would be more reliable and see things more their way. It's a chilly, but in a much more muted and sophisticated and subtle form.
After his dismissal, Gough Whitlam was unsuccessful when he stood again for Prime Minister in the subsequent national elections.
Big cheer for the Prime Minister, hip hip!
Inside the Black Vault at TRW in Los Angeles, Chris Boyce monitored the CIA's activities during this election. Boyce later told what he had found out to Victor Marchetti.
He learned that the CIA was bribing labor union leaders and providing funds to manipulate the elections. And this was one of the things that turned him off. He said to himself, if we do these kinds of things to our own allies, then what kind of a moral government do we have?
In 1977, Dalton Lee was arrested by Mexican police on a charge of littering. He had been attempting to make contact with the KGB by throwing a message through the fence surrounding the Soviet embassy in Mexico City. Christopher Boyce was arrested 10 days later after U.S. officials in Mexico City discovered top-secret documents among Dalton Lee's belongings.
The CIA rode that trial very hard. They didn't want it to take place in the first place. I personally believe that they didn't want to arrest Boyce. They gave him 10 days between the time of that they arrested his colleague and his own arrest. And I think they would have been much happier had he skipped the country, had the Russians looked after him. But they didn't, and Boyce didn't want to run. So they rode this trial. They didn't allow a lot of things to be said. Whenever Australia was mentioned, there was an arrangement, which Boyce's lawyers confirmed to me, that they would stay out of what was called sensitive areas. That is, areas which the CIA regarded as being potentially damaging to its interest. So that when he began to mention Australia, destabilization, comparisons with Chile, the prosecution counsel leapt up and objected, and the judge automatically accepted that objection, and the subject was dropped.
In January 1980, Christopher Boyce escaped from the maximum security prison at Lompoc, California. After 19 months on the run, he was recaptured by the FBI. His full story is still to be told.
The future of the cause of freedom around the world depends so greatly on the leadership of the United States. There are so many things that will not be done unless the United States is prepared to do them. But, Mr. President, Australians are a people given to forming our own views, and it's this spirit of independence that makes us determined to contribute effectively to the cause of peace and of freedom.
Nancy and I are pleased to be able to welcome you and Mrs. Fraser as representatives of a country with whom we are proud to be allied in a world where freedom and democracy are constantly challenged. As Sir Robert Menzies said, we work for the same kind of free world.
Can we be sure that our sovereignty is unimpaired? That is, that we do have effective control over the operations that go through the centre. The defence people who spoke to us in Canberra put it this way, that if they're worried, they can pull the plug out. Well, we need more reassurance than that, so we've got to explore that further.
We have had what appears to be a convincing demonstration that there is no derogation of Australian sovereignty at this base, and more than that, it is not part of some weapon system.
I repeat, they are not parts of weapon systems. They cannot be used to make war on any country.
The role of the base is quite clear and limited in its definition. We can't disclose any of those functions.
We cannot disclose any more about their purposes, because they're not our secrets.
What we're saying is that instead of jumping to conclusions and being speculative, perhaps even sensationalist about this, we need to have in this community an informed, restrained, but concerned debate.
To those neighbors and allies who share our freedom, we will strengthen our historic ties
and assure them of our support and firm commitment. We will match loyalty with loyalty. We will strive for mutually beneficial relations. We will not use our friendship to impose on their sovereignty, for our own sovereignty is not for sale. As for the enemies of freedom, they will be reminded that peace is the highest aspiration of the American people. We will negotiate for it, sacrifice for it. We will not surrender for it now or ever.